The arm of UN Agenda 21 is long and reaches into every area of the world. The philosophy of communitarianism pervades this plan. To want government to serve the people by providing services, infrastructure, and protection is not contradictory to objecting to the imposition of restrictions that break the hearts and wallets of property owners. Communitarianism balances the rights of the individual with the so-called rights of the community. Because the rights of the community are not defined in a constitution, they can change without warning or notice. One's individual rights are balanced against a continuously redefined amorphous rulebook. This rulebook is written in the dark. And the individual runs up against it at dawn, and alone. The slogan of UN Agenda 21, to protect the rights of future generations and all species against the potential crimes of the present, is both a smokescreen and a declaration of entitlement. By standing on this high-sounding premise, the rights of the individual are called selfish, and those who would fight for them, slurred as immoral. The philosophy that by merely living and exhaling we pose a direct danger to the earth is self-destructive and truly damaging to those lands that we steward. The green mask must be drawn back, far back from the personalities. The little dictators running trusts, foundations, planning departments, city and town councils, provinces and states, non-governmental foundations and the like. The green mask must be removed from those who have hijacked the environmental movement. Behind the money in green, the more than $5 trillion in private money poised to make green loans, the carbon credit brokers, the enormous wealth in purchasing landfills, carbon sinks, inaccessible lands in third world countries, behind that greed which one would expect, look behind that. Find what intelligent, educated people the world over look away from as from a spotlight. There is a plan for world governance that is in place, and eating like a metastasized cancer into every nation, free and bound, in the world. Under the banner of saving the planet, we are drowning liberty. Under the mask of green, our civil liberties are being restricted, constricted, and suffocated in every village and hamlet. The plan is imposed locally. Your government is a corporatocracy, a new authoritarian state in the process of consolidating your output into a more controllable, exploitable channel. The reason you are being misled by your government and told that all of this is good for you is because there is no profit in managing a mass uprising. It is too disruptive. The markets want you to continue to cooperate, quietly and obediently. The technology that is being marketed to you is actually being used to condition you to expect to be spied on, and to spy on others. Every totalitarian state in history has relied on data collection. The Nazis were masters of data collection and analysis. Your government now has technological capabilities that far exceed anything ever seen on the earth to this date. You are in the midst of the biggest public relations scam in the history of the world. The pretty pastel vision of life in a smart growth development is a manipulation, a mask. In fact, these plans are designed to restrict your freedom. Awareness is the first step in the resistance. Communitarianism is the balancing of the individual's rights against those of the community. In the US Constitution, we are guaranteed rights that we were born with: life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The last right, under the philosophy of John Locke, was property. Property is not just land. You are your own property. The execration of slavery was a fundamental element in the original draft of the Declaration of Independence. So how can you balance individual rights with those of the community? The community has no rights under the US Constitution. Individuals have rights and responsibilities, but the community as a whole, what is that? The collective. Whenever you balance or subsume or subordinate or consensusize the individual's rights, you'll get something different from what we are guaranteed under the Constitution. Here's an example. Let's take two glasses and set them on a table. One glass is full of water. Let's call it a constitutional republic. The other glass is full of milk. Let's call it a communitarian state. Now we'll get a glass pitcher and set it on the table. Let's balance the water with the milk by pouring them both into the pitcher. What do you have? It's not water anymore, is it? It's milk. Watery milk. But milk. Not water. The third way. Communitarianism. Balancing your individual rights with the rights of the community. Defined now as the global community. This is being pitched to you as the new enlightened form of political discourse. You are selfish if you insist on your individual rights and freedoms. This is the justification for UN Agenda 21 or sustainable development. For the good of the planet. For everyone's security. For your health. To protect your children. To limit workplace violence. To stop bullying. to protect the rights of those in the future. All of these are laudable ideas, but somehow they always result in more restrictive laws that affect everyone. They criminalize everyone. In many towns, simple ordinances have been criminalized. What does that mean? If you don't mow your lawn, it's a violation. Will your child have a criminal record if he calls another kid a queer? Will you be held responsible if your employee shoots someone and you knew he was upset over a breakup with his wife? Will your 15-year-old daughter be strip searched at the airport? Will you lose custody of your 10-year-old because he is obese? Will you be evicted from your apartment because you smoked on your balcony in violation of a local ordinance? Will you be taxed for driving 15 miles to work instead of riding your bike? Will you be fined for watering your vegetable garden? Will your smart meter be used to tell advertisers what to sell you? Will your smart vehicle with remote shut-off capability be shut down by someone in your state capital while you're driving? Will your neighbor report you to the community-oriented policing unit of your local police department because you seem to be acting strangely? Will you be denied the right to use the water in your well? Will you be required to pay triple your original electricity rates because your town has decided to go into the power business, community aggregate power generation? Will you be required to donate acres of your ranch land for county open space before you can put a house on it? Will you pay years of property tax without receiving any services for it because redevelopment debt has crippled your city? Will you be required to do your mandatory volunteering before you can get your child into Little League? Will you be accused of not caring about the planet if you question sustainable development? Your rights have been balanced. Welcome to the new world order of the 21st century. Before I continue the video, please smash that like button for me. Thank you. Okay, what is UN Agenda 21? And why should I care? Have you wondered where these terms sustainability and smart growth and high-density urban mixed-use development came from? Doesn't it seem that about 10 years ago you'd never heard of them, and now everything seems to include these buzzwords? Is that just a coincidence? That every town and country and state and nation in the world would be changing their land user planning codes and government policies to align themselves with what? First, before I get going, I want to say that yes, I know it really is a small world, and we're all one planet, etc. I also know that we have a government of the people, by the people and for the people, and that as cumbersome as that can be sometimes, Donald Rumsfeld said that the Chinese have it easy, they don't have to ask their people if they agree. And Bush Jr. said that it would be great to have a dictator, as long as he was the dictator, we have a three-branch government and the Bill of Rights, Constitution, and self-determination. This is one of the reasons why people want to come to the US, right? We don't have Tiananmen Square here, generally speaking, yes, I remember Kent State, not the same, and yes, an outrage. So I'm not against making certain issues a priority, such as mindful energy use, alternative energy sponsorship, recycling reuse, and sensitivity to all living creatures. But then you have UN Agenda 21. What is it? Considering its policies are woven into all of the general plans of the cities and counties in the United States, it's important for people to know where these policies are coming from. While many support the United Nations for its peacemaking efforts, few know that it has very specific land use policies that it wants implemented in every city, county, state, and nation. The specific plan is called United Nations Agenda 21 Sustainable Development, which has its basis in communitarianism. By now, most Americans have heard of sustainable development, but are largely unaware of Agenda 21, the agenda for the 21st century. In a nutshell, the plan calls for governments to take control of all land use and not leave any of the decision-making in the hands of private property owners. It is assumed that people are not good stewards of their land, and the government will do a better job if it is in control. Individual rights in general are to give way to the needs of communities as determined by a globalist governing body. Moreover, people should be rounded up off of the land and packed into human settlements or islands of human habitation, as they are called in the UN Agenda 21 documents, close to employment centers and transportation. Another program, called the Wildlands Project, spells out how most of the land is to be set aside for non-humans. In anticipation of our objections to such plans, our civil rights will be dissolved. UN Agenda 21 cites the affluence of Americans as being a major problem which needs to be corrected. It calls for lowering the standard of living for Americans so that the people in poorer countries will have more, a redistribution of wealth. Although people around the world aspire to achieve the levels of prosperity we have in our country and will risk their lives to get here, Americans are cast in a very negative light and will be taken down to a condition closer to average in the world. Only then will there be social justice, which is a cornerstone of the UN Agenda 21 plan. UN Agenda 21 policies date back to the 1970s, but it got its real start in 1992 at the United Nations Earth Summit in Rio de Janeiro, when President Bush signed onto it along with the leaders of 178 other countries. Because it is a soft law, it did not have to be ratified by the Congress. The following year, President Clinton began to implement it by creating the President's Council on Sustainable Development, or PCSD. Made up of cabinet-level government officials, captains of industry, including Ken Lay of Enron, and non-profit groups such as the Sierra Club, one of the first tasks of the PCSD was to give a multi-million dollar grant to the American Planning Association to design a legislative guidebook to be used as a blueprint for every city, county, and state in the United States in order to implement UN Agenda 21. This document, called Growing Smart Legislative Guidebook, Model Statutes for Planning and the Management of Change, took 7 years to complete and a full 9 years to arrive at the final version. The guidebook, and it's not just a guidebook but a blueprint, contains sample legislation, ordinances, rules, regulations and statutes to be incorporated into the general plans of every single city and county in the United States. By 2002, every planning department and every local, state, and federal department that governs land use had a copy and was implementing the practices. Every university, every college, every junior college, private school and teaching institution in our nation was using Growing Smart in its curriculum. Sound familiar? Growing Smart is smart growth. A non-governmental organization called the International Council of Local Environmental Initiatives, ICLEI, is tasked with carrying out the goals of UN Agenda 21 locally. Over 600 cities and counties in the US are members. The costs are paid by taxpayers. Okay, you say, interesting, but I don't see how that really affects me. Here are a few ways. No matter where you live, I'll bet that there have been hundreds of condos built or planned in the center of your town recently. Over the last 10 years there has been a planning revolution across the US. It was the implementation of Growing Smart. Your commercial, industrial, and multi-residential land was rezoned to mixed use. Nearly everything that got approvals for development was designed the same way. Ground floor retail with two or three stories of residential above. Mixed use. Very hard to finance for construction, and very hard to manage since it has to have a high density of people in order to justify the retail. A lot of it is empty, and most of the ground floor retail is empty too. High bankruptcy rate. So what? Most of your towns provided funding and/or infrastructure development for these private projects. They used redevelopment agency funds. Your money. Specifically, your property taxes. Notice how there's very little money in your general funds now, and most of that is going to pay police and fire. Your streetlights are off, your parks are shaggy, your roads are potholed, your county hospitals are closing. The money that should be used for these things is diverted into the redevelopment agency for 30 years. It's the only agency in government that can float a bond without a vote of the people. And they did that, and now you're paying off those bonds for the next 30 to 45 years with your property taxes. Did you know that? So, what does this have to do with Agenda 21? Redevelopment is a tool used to further the Agenda 21 vision of remaking America's cities. With redevelopment, cities have the right to take property by eminent domain, against the will of the property owner, and give it or sell it to a private developer. By declaring an area of town blighted, and in some cities over 90% of the city area has been declared blighted, the property taxes in that area are diverted away from the general fund. This constriction of available funds is impoverishing the cities, forcing them to offer less and less services, and reducing your standard of living. They'll be telling you that it's better, however, since they've put in nice streetlights and colored paving downtown. The money gets redirected into the redevelopment agency and handed out to favored developers building low-income housing and mixed use. Smart growth. Cities have had thousands of condos built in the redevelopment areas and are telling you that you are terrible for wanting your own yard, for wanting privacy, for not wanting to be dictated to by a condo homeowners association board, for being antisocial, for not going along to get along, for not moving into a cramped overpriced apartment downtown where they can use your property taxes for paying off that huge bond debt. But it's not working and you don't want to move in there, so they have to make you. Read on. Human habitation, as it is referred to now, is restricted to lands within the urban growth boundaries of the city. Only certain building designs are permitted. Rural property is more and more restricted in what uses can be on it. Although counties say that they support agricultural uses, eating locally produced food, farmers markets, etc., in fact there are so many regulations restricting water and land use, there are scenic corridors, inland rural corridors, baylands corridors, area plans, specific plans, redevelopment plans, huge fees, fines, that farmers are losing their lands altogether. County roads are not being paved. The pushes for people to get off of the land, become more dependent, come into the cities. To get out of the suburbs and into the cities. out of their private homes and into condos, out of their private cars and onto their bikes. Bikes. What does that have to do with it? I like to ride my bike and so do you. So what? Bicycle advocacy groups are very powerful now. Advocacy. A fancy word for lobbying, influencing, and maybe strong-arming the public and politicians. What's the connection with bike groups? National groups such as Complete Streets, Thunderhead Alliance, and others have training programs teaching their members how to pressure for redevelopment and training candidates for office. It's not just about bike lanes, it's about remaking cities and rural areas to the sustainable model. High-density urban development without parking for cars is the goal. They call them transit villages. This means that whole towns need to be demolished and rebuilt in the image of sustainable development. Bike groups, often dominated by testosterone-laden zealots, are being used as the shock troops for this plan. What plan? We're losing our homes since this recession depression began, and many of us could never afford those homes to begin with. We got cheap money, used whatever we had to squeak into those homes, and now some of us lost them. We were lured, indebted, and sunk. Whole neighborhoods are empty in some places. Some are being bulldozed. Cities cannot afford to extend services outside of their core areas. Slowly, people will not be able to afford single-family homes. Will not be able to afford private cars. Will be more dependent. More restricted. More easily watched and monitored. This plan is a whole life plan. It involves the educational system, the energy market, the transportation system, the governmental system, the healthcare system, food production, and more. The plan is to restrict your choices, limit your funds, narrow your freedoms, and take away your voice. One of the ways is by using the Delphi technique to manufacture consensus. Another is to infiltrate community groups or actually start neighborhood associations with hand-picked leaders. Another is to groom and train future candidates for local offices. Another is to sponsor non-governmental groups that go into schools and train children. Another is to offer federal and private grants and funding for local programs that further the agenda. Another is to educate a new generation of land use planners to require new urbanism. Another is to convert factories to other uses, introduce energy measures that penalize manufacturing, and set energy consumption goals to pre-1985 levels. Another is to allow unregulated immigration in order to lower standards of living and drain local resources. Everything that has happened was meant to happen by your government. Comment below with more topic ideas for me to discuss. As a lot of care and hard work goes into this, likes and subscribe, let me know I'm doing a good job. All is appreciated greatly. You may not agree with everything from the content I post. Apply critical thinking and use discernment to come to your own conclusions regarding the content. Thanks for watching this video. This Everything Inside Me channel, see you on the next video. Stay safe and healthy.